tell you for the 100th time, Mr. Kemper, you will never marry my niece.
And I'll tell you for the 1,000th time, Mr. Vandegelder, that I will. Right and soon, too.
Never, boys.
Your niece is of age, Mr. Vandegelder. Furthermore, your niece has consented to marry me. This is a free country, Mr. Vandegelder, not just some private kingdom of your own.
There are no free countries for fools, Mr. Kemper. I thank you for the honor of your visit. Good morning.
Mr. Vandegelder, will you please sit still for a minute? If I cut your throat, it'll be... Well, it'll be practically unintentional.
Evergard is not for you, nor is she for anybody else who can't support you. Oh,
but I tell you, I can support her. I make a very good living.
No, sir. A living is made by selling something that everybody needs at least once a year.
Well, yes, sir.
And a million is made by producing something that everybody needs every day. You artists produce something that nobody needs at any time.
That is not true.
You may sell a picture once in a while, but you'll make no living. Joe, go over there and get Cornelius for me. I want to talk to him.
Listen, not only can I support her now, but I tell you, I have considerable expectations.
Expectations? Let me tell you something, Mr. Kemper. We merchants don't do business with them. I don't keep accounts with people who promise to pay me something someday, and I won't allow my niece to marry such people. No, no, Mr. Kemper. You go back to your studio, and when you're finished painting your picture of the sunset on the Hudson, why don't you try hope, feeding a family, or love, mounting a snowbank? There's a subject for you.
Very well then, Mr. Vandegelder. Then you might as well know that I can find any way to marry her. God, I see it as right and fair. She's of age and there is no law.
Law? Let me tell you something, Mr. Kemper. The law is there to prevent crime. We men of sense are there to prevent foolishness. It is I and not the law that will prevent Emmergard from marrying you. I've taken some steps already. I've sent her away.
You sent her away?
Yes, to get this nonsense out of her head.
What do you mean? She's not here.
You can find her at Peekskill or Albany or Syracuse or Dry Utica. I thank you for the honor of your visit.
Everything's ready, Mr. Vandegelder. I have just finished packing the truck. Ermengarde's been helping me.
Hold your tongue.
Yes, Mr. Vandegelder, Ermengarde's ready to leave. Her truck's all marked Care, Miss Van Huysen, 8 Jackson Street, New York.
Then damnation! I tell you it was a secret.
Care, Miss Van Huysen, 8 Jackson Street, New York. Thank you very much, Mr. Vandegelder.
Won't help you, Mr. Kemper.
Good morning.
Death. At least you can do me the favor of being dumb.
Such a temper. Lord save us.
Oh, yes, Mr. Vandegelder.
Go and get my niece's trunk and carry it over to the front of the station in half an hour.
Yes, Mr. Vandegelder.
Wait. Gertrude, has Miss Levi arrived yet?
Don't shout. I can hear perfectly well. Certainly the labels for the luggage are ready.
This morning I'm leading my lodge for a dispute for DeVille. This afternoon I'm going to New York. Before I leave, I have something important to say to you. Good news. Fact is, I'm going to promote you. How old are you?
I'm 33, Mr. Vandegelder.
What's that?
33.
It's a foolish age to be at. I thought you were at least 40.
No, I'm 33.
A man's not worth a cent till he's 40. Isn't that right, Joe? We just pay him wages to make mistakes.
You almost lost near it, Mr. Vandegelder.
I was thinking of promoting you to chief clerk.
What am I now, Mr. Vandegelder?
You're an impertinent fool. That's what you are. But if you behave yourself, I'll promote you from impertinent fool to chief clerk for raising your wages. And Barnaby from idiot apprentice to incompetent clerk.
Thank you, Mr. Vandegelder.
But I want to see you again before I leave.
Yes, Mr. Vandegelder.
Joe, like my father used to say, the horse will be taken over soon.
Here.
Fine.
I did what I could, Mr. Vandegelder, with you flying in and out of the chair.
Fine, Joe. You do a fine job. Same fine job you've done for me for 20 years. Joe, I've got a little reason for looking my best today. Isn't there something a little extra you could do? Something a little special?
Huh?
I'll pay you right up for 50 cents. See what I mean? Do something those things you do to the young fellas. Touch me up. Smart me up a bit.
I noticed 15 cents with like usual, Mr. Vandegelder, and that includes everything that's decent to do to a man.
Now, what's your horses, Joe? All I meant was...
I've shaved you for 20 years, and you've never asked me no such questions before, and I don't intend...
Now, what's your horses, I say, Joe? I'm going to tell you something. I don't want you telling it to that riffraff down at the barbershop when I'm going to tell you now. All I ask of you is a little extra, because I'm thinking I'm getting married. And this afternoon, I'm going to New York to call my attendant, a very refined lady.
You're getting married is none of my business, Mr. Vandegelder. I've shaved you for 20 years. The charge is 15 cents like it always was. And I don't dye no hair, not even for 50 cents, I don't.
Joe Scanlon, get out.
And lastly, it seems to me like you're pretty rash judge which is fools and which isn't fools, Mr. Vandegelder. People who aren't Indians are poor judges of who's at onions and who ain't. Good morning, ladies. Good morning, Mr. Vandegelder.
The world's going to pieces. They're flooding the country. The asylums can't hold them all. What do you want?
Uncle, you said you wanted to talk to us?
Oh, yes. Gertrude, go on and get my parade regalia, the uniform for my lodge parade.
What? Oh, yes. Lord have mercy.
I'm going to talk with that artist of yours.
Oh, but you did?
Yes, I did. He's a fool. Weeping, weeping. You can go down and weep for a while in New York where it won't be noticed. Ermengarde. I simply told him that when you're old enough to marry someone, you'll marry someone that can support you. I've done you a good deed. You'll come and thank me when you're 50.
But, Uncle, I love him.
I tell you, you don't.
But I do.
And I tell you, you don't. Leave those things to me.
Uncle, if I don't marry Ambrose, I know I'll die.
What of?
A broken heart.
Never heard of it. Miss Levi's coming in a minute or two to take you to New York. You're going to stay 2 or 3 weeks in Miss Florban High, an old friend of your mother's. You're not to receive any letters from anyone except from me. I'm coming to New York this afternoon, and I'll call on you tomorrow. Who are you?
Malachi Stack, Your Honor. I heard you need an apprentice in the hayfield profession and hardware business.
An apprentice at your age?
Yes, indeed, Your Honor. I bring a lot of experience.
Have you any letters recommendations?
Well, yes, indeed, Your Honor. First class recommendations.
Ermengarde, are you ready to start?
Yes.
Well, go on and get ready some more. Ermengarde, let me know the minute Miss Levi gets here.
Yes, Uncle Horace.
Off of me. I don't want an able seaman, nor do I want a typesetter, and I don't want a hospital cook.
No, it's all experience, Your Honor. Excuse me. Ah, this one's from your former partner. A Joshua Von Tool in Albany.
Von Tool. For the most part, honest and reliable. Occasionally, willing and diligent. There seems to be some sort of hesitation about these recommendations.
Businessmen aren't writers, Your Honor. There's one businessman in 1,000 who can write a good letter of recommendation. Mr. Von Tool sends his best wishes and wants to know if you can use me in the provision and hardware business.
Not so fast. Tell me, why did you decide to come to Yonkers?
Well, I heard you had an apprentice that was good for nothing. You're at your wit's end for another.
Wit's end? There's no dearth of good for nothing apprentices.
You're right, Your Honor. It's a ploy that there's a dearth of. It seems like you have a new one dying every day.
What's your top? So you've been a barber and a valet too. Why'd you change your place so often?
Change my place? Mr. Vandegelder, when a man's interested in experience.
Do you drink?
Why, no, thank you. I just had breakfast.
I didn't ask you whether you. I asked if you were a drunkard.
Why, no, sir. No. Why, looking at it from all sides, I don't even like liquor.
Well, looking at it from all sides, out you go. Remember that. For all your faults, I'm willing to give you a chance.
You'll never regret it, Mr. Vandegelder. You'll never regret it.
I'm judging you know your way around New York.
Do I know my way around New York? Mr. Vandegelder, I know every hole and corner of New York.
Here's a dollar.
Oh, thanks.
Take this back to the Central Hotel on Water Street. Have them send me a room. I'll be there at about 4 o'clock, and I'll meet you then.
Oh. I'd like to meet the other clerks. I'm to work.
Oh, you haven't any time. Go on, off with you now.
Yes, Mr. Vandegelder. You'll see, Mr. Vandegelder. You'll never regret it.
I regret it already. 99% of the people in the world are fools. And the rest of us are in great danger of contagion. But I wasn't always free of foolishness as I am now. I was once young, which was foolish. Fell in love, which was foolish. And I got married, which was foolish. And for a while I was poor, which is more foolish than all the other things put together. And my wife died, which was foolish of her. I grew older, which was sensible of me. And I became a very rich man, which is as sensible as it is rare. Since you see I'm a man of sense, I guess you were surprised to hear that I'm planning to get married. Well, I have 2 reasons for it. In the first place, I like my house run of order, comfort, and economy. And that's a woman's work. But even a woman can't do it well if she's merely being paid for it. You see, in order to run a house well, a woman must have the feeling that she owns it. Marriage is like a bride that makes a housekeeper think she's a householder. Have you ever watched an ant carry a burden twice its size? What excitement, what patience, what will. That's what I think of when I see a woman running a house. What giant passions in those little bodies. What quarrels with the butcher for the best cut. What fury at discovering a moth in the cupboard. Believe me, if women can harness their natures to something bigger than a baby carriage and a house, they change the world. My second reason, ladies and gentlemen, I can see by your faces already, you've guessed it. There's nothing like mixing with women to bring out all the foolishness in a man of sense. And that's a risk I'm willing to take. I just turned 60 and I laid side by side my first half million. So, I should lose my head a little while. I have enough money to buy it back. After many years of caution and hard work, I have the right to a little risk and adventure. I'm thinking of getting married. Yes, just like all of you other fools out there, I'm willing to risk a certain amount of security for a certain amount of adventure. Think it over.
Rose, if my uncle saw you...
Just get your hat.
My hat?
Shh. No, quick, quick. The truck is at the station. We're running away.
Running away? Shh. Where?
To New York. To be married.
Oh, no, Ambrose, I can't do that.
Why?
Why? It wouldn't be proper.
Well, listen, listen, listen. I have a friend there, and his wife can take very good care of you.
Ambrose, a girl can't get on the train with a man. I see you don't know anything about girls.
But I'm telling you, we're going to be married.
Married? What would uncle say?
I don't care. We don't care what your uncle would say. We are eloping.
Eloping? How could you say such an awful word?
Thank God you have the soul, Field Mouse.
Ambrose Kemper, why do you say such cruel things to me?
Come now, the train leaves in a few moments. Just get your things and let's go.
Good morning, darling girl. How are you? Dear, who is this gentleman who's so devoted to you, huh?
Mrs. Levi, Mrs. Ambrose, this is Mrs. Levi.
Oh, Mrs. Levi, Born Gallagher, very happy to meet you, Mr. Kemper. Mr. Kemper, the artist, delighted. Mr. Kemper, may I say something very frankly?
Yes, Miss Levi.
This thing you were planning to do was a very great mistake.
Oh, Mrs. Levi, of course I want to marry Ambrose, but to elope.
Oh, now, my dear girl, you go in and keep one eye on your uncle. I wish to talk to Mr. Kemper for a moment. You have a warning when you hear your Uncle Horace coming. Mr. Kemper, I was that dear girl's mother's oldest friend. Believe me, I'm on your side. I wish for you two to be married very soon. I think I can say I can be of real service to you. Mr. Kemper, I always go right to the point.
What is your point, Miss Levi?
Mr. Vandegelder is a very rich man, Mr. Kemper, and Ermengarde is his only relative.
Oh, no. I'm not interested in any of Mr. Vandegelder's money. I have enough to support a wife and family of my own.
Enough? How much is enough when one is thinking about children in the future? The future is the most expensive luxury in the world, Mr. Kemper.
What's your point, Miss Levi?
Believe me, Mr. Vandegelder wishes to get rid of Ermengarde. If you follow my suggestions, he may even permit her to marry you. You see, Mr. Vandegelder is planning on getting married himself.
What? Uh-huh. That monster!
Mr. Kemper!
Married to who? You, Miss Levi?
No. No. I'm merely arranging it. I'm helping him find a suitable bride.
Oh, for Mr. Vandegelder. There are no suitable brides.
I think we can safely say that Mr. Vandegelder will be married to someone by the end of next week.
Just what do you suppose, Miss Levi?
I'm taking Ermengarde with me on the next train to New York. I shall not take her to Miss Van Huysen's as is planned. I shall take her to my house. I wish you to call for her at my house at 5:30. Here's my card.
Miss Dolly Gallagher Levi, varicose veins reduce.
I beg your pardon.
Oh, I beg your pardon, says consultations are free.
Oh, I meant to give you my other card. Here you are.
Miss Dolly Gallagher Levi, guitar and mandolin lessons are our hosiery. Miss Levi, do you really do all these things?
2 and 2 make 4, Mr. Kemper, and they always did. So you come to my house at 5:30. At about 6, I shall take you both meet to the Harmonia Gardens restaurant on the Battery. Mr. Vandegelder will be there and everything will be arranged.
How?
Oh, I don't know. One thing will lead to another.
Miss Levi, how do I know I can trust you? You could easily make our situation much worse.
Mr. Kemper, your situation could not possibly be worse.
Well, what are you getting out of this, Miss Levi?
Oh, that is a very proper question. I get 2 things, profit and pleasure.
How's that?
Mr. Kemper, I'm a woman who arranges things. At present, I'm arranging Mr. Vandegelder's domestic affairs. Out of what I get, shall we call it? Yes, why don't we? Little pickings? I need little pickings, Mr. Kemper, especially now, when I haven't got my train fare back to New York. You see, I'm frank with you.
Well, yes, you are, but that's your profit, so what's your pleasure?
My pleasure, Mr. Kemper. When you artists paint a hillside or a river, you change everything a little. You make thousands of little changes, don't you? Nature in itself is never completely satisfactory and must be corrected. Well, I'm like you artists. Life as it is never quite interesting enough for me. I'm bored, Mr. Kemper, with life as it is. So I do things. I put my hand in here, and I put my hand in there, and I watch, and I listen. And often I'm very much amused.
Oh, not my affairs, Miss Levi.
Wait, I haven't finished. There's another thing. I'm very interested in this household here, and Mr. Vandegelder, and all that idle, frozen money of his. I don't like the thought of it lying in great piles, useless, motionless in the bank. Money should be circulating like rainwater, should be flowing down among the people through dressmakers and restaurants and cabmen, setting up a little business here, furnishing a good time there. Do you see what I mean?
Yes, I do, Miss Levi.
New York should be a very happy city, Mr. Kemper, but it isn't. My late husband came from Vienna, Mr. Ephraim Levi. Oh, my. Now, there's a city that understands this. Irish for New York to be a little bit more like Vienna and less like a collection of nervous and tired ants. And if you and Ermengarde get a good deal of Mr. Vandegelder's money, I want you to see that starts flowing in and around a lot of people's lives.
That is a good idea, Miss Levi.
Oh, Miss Levi, Uncle Forrest is here.
Oh, Miss Kemper, I think you'd better be going. Darling girl, Mr. Kemper and I have had a very good talk, you'll see. Mr. Vandegelder and I will be dancing at your wedding very, very soon. Don't you worry, dear girl. Mr. Vandegelder, how handsome you look! You take my breath away! Yes, my dear girl, I'll see you soon! Oh, Mr. Vandegelder, if only Irene Malloy could see you now! But then, I don't know what's come over lately. You see me growing younger every day.
Allowing for exaggeration, Miss Levi. If a man eats well, there's no reason he should look old.
You've never said a true word.
I'll never see 60, 55 again.
55? Why, I can see at a glance that you're the sort that'll be standing about at 100, eating 5 meals a day, just like what's his name? Michael Harry, 55. Michael Harry's a mere boy. Oh, I'm a judge of hands, Miss Vandegelder. Show me your hand. Lord in heaven, what a lifeline!
Yeah.
From here to here, oh, it runs right off your hand. I don't know where it goes. That'll have to hit you on there with a mallet. That'll stifle you, the soap bubble. You'll bury us all. Oh, however, to return to our business, Miss Vandegelder, I suppose you've changed your mind again. I suppose you've given up all idea of getting married.
Not at all, Miss Levi. I have news for you.
News?
Miss Levi,
mm-hmm.
I practically asked Miss Malloy to become my wife.
You have?
Yes, I have.
Oh, you have? Well, I guess that's about the best news I ever heard. Oh, dear me. So there's nothing more for me to do but wish you every happiness under the sun and say goodbye.
Well, surely I thought
Well, I did have a suggestion to make, but I won't. You're going to marry Irene Malloy, and that closes the matter.
What was it?
Well, I had found another girl for you.
Another?
The most wonderful girl, the ideal wife.
Another?
Uh-huh.
What's her name?
Her name?
Yes, her name.
Her name, Ernestina. Simple, Miss Ernestina Simple. Oh, now, of course, all that's too late. After all, you're engaged. You're practically engaged to marry Irene Malloy.
Oh, I ain't engaged.
Nonsense, you can't break poor Irene's heart. Now it changed to another girl, Mr. Vandegelder. When a man at your time of life calls four times on a tractor poodle like that and sends her a pot of geraniums, that's practically an engagement.
Ain't an engagement.
Not yet, if only you were free. I found this treasure of a girl every moment. I felt like a traitor, Irene Malloy, but let me tell you, I couldn't help it. I told this girl all about you. This is though you were a free man, isn't that dreadful? The fact is, she has fallen in love with you already. Ernestina Simple.
Ernestina Simple.
Of course, she's a very different idea from Miss Malloy. Ernestina is like her name. Simple. Huh. Domestic. Practical.
Can she cook?
Cook? Miss Vandegelder, I've had two meals from her hands, and as I live, I don't know what I've done. The gosh reward me with such meals. I'm best cooking with myself, and I know what's good.
What is her age, Miss Levi?
19. Well, say 20.
19. Miss Levi, girls of that age are apt to favor young fellows of their own age, don't you think?
But you don't listen to me, and you don't know the girl, Miss Vandegelder. She has a positive horror, a flighty, brainless young man. A fine head of gray hair, she says, is worth 20 shot with you as grease.
That's not usual, Miss Levi.
Usual? I'm not wearing myself to the bone, hunting up usual girls' interest too, Mr. Vandegelder. Usual indeed. Listen to me. Do you know the sort of picture she has on her walls? Is it these young Romeos in Lochinvar's? No! It's Moses on the Mountain, that's what she's got. Give her a picture of Methuselah surrounded by his grandchildren. That's my advice to you.
What is her family?
Her father, God be good to him. He was the best. What am I trying to say? Undertaker. The best undertaker in all of Brooklyn. Respected, esteemed. Knew all those best people, knew them well, even before they died. So, well, that's all there is to it. Now, let me tell you a little bit more about her appearance. Can you hear me? As I say, a beautiful girl, beautiful. I've seen her walk down the street, you know what I mean? The young men get dizzy. They've been leaning against the lamppost, and she modest eyes on the ground. I'm not going to tell you anymore. Couldn't you come to New York today?
Well, actually, I was planning on coming to New York this afternoon.
Really? Well, she's so eager to meet you. I wish something could be arranged. Let me see.
Levi, do you think I could treat you two ladies to a dinner?
Really, come to think of it, I don't see where I have the time. Yes, I'm all tangled up in that wretched lawsuit of mine. I don't mind telling you, if I win, I'll be called a very rich woman. I'll own half Staten Island, that's a fact. But just now, I'm at my wit's end for just a little bit of money to finish off my wit's end. But perhaps I could arrange a little dinner, I'll see. Yes, for that lawsuit, all I need is $50.
$50?
Two whole months, I
$50, Miss Levi, is no joke. I don't know where money's going these days. It's in hiding. Here. Here's 20, 25. Yeah, this is all I can do now. No more, I can't.
Well, this will help. Will help somewhat. Now, I'll tell you what we'll do. I'll bring Ernestine to that restaurant on the Battery. You know it, the Harmonia Gardens. It's good, but it's not flashy. I think just this once you should order a real nice dinner. I guess you can afford it.
Well, I guess just this once.
A chicken wouldn't hurt.
Chicken?
Uh-huh.
Just this once, Miss Levi.
And a little wine.
Just this once, Miss Levi.
Now about Mrs. Malloy, what do you think? Shall we call that subject closed?
No. I still want to have dinner with Mrs. Miss...
Simple!
Miss Simple. But first, I like to call on Miss Malloy.
Dear, and Miss Simple? What races you make me run. Very well, why don't you meet me outside of Mrs. Malloy's hat shop at 4:30, as usual.
Buggy's here, ready for the parade, Mr.
Going to get Barnaby. I want to talk to both of you.
Yes, Mr. Vandergelder.
Now, do put your thoughts in order, Mr. Vandergelder. I can't keep upsetting and disturbing the finest women in New York City unless you mean business.
Well, I mean business, Miss Levi.
I hope so, because you know you're playing a very dangerous game.
Dangerous?
Yes, it is dangerous, and there's a name for it! You're tampering with these women's affections, aren't you? And the only way to save yourself now is to be married to someone by the end of next week. So think that over.
This morning I'm leading my lodge for a dispute for the ville. When I come back, there are going to be some changes around here. Now, I'm going to tell you two what they are, but I don't want you two discussing it amongst yourselves. You're going to have a mistress.
I'm too young, Mr. Vandergelder.
Not towards any of mine! Get the damnation off your tongue until you're spoken to! I'm thinking of getting married.
Oh, many congratulations, Mr. Vandergelder, and my compliments to the ladies.
That's none of your business. Now go on back to the shop. Have you two any questions you want to ask me before I leave?
Mr. Vandergelder.
Yes, Cornelius.
Mr. Vandergelder.
Yes, Cornelius.
Does the chief clerk get an evening off each week?
So that's the way you began being chief clerk, asking for evenings off. When I was your age, I woke up at 5. I worked all day in the shop until 10, and then I spent an extra hour in the account books. The world's going to pieces. You elegant ladies lie in bed until 6. And at 9 o'clock at night, you rush to the door so fast the line of customers bark their noses. No, sir. You remain in the shop until close, and on Friday and Saturday nights until 10. Now hear what I say. This is the first time I've been away from the shop overnight. If I come back and I hear any foolishness, any, both discharged. If you keep asking for evenings off, you'll find yourself with all of your days free. Remember that. And don't forget to put the lid on the sheep dip.
The horses knew he ran away when they saw him. Woohoo! There he goes. What's the matter, Cornelius?
Chief clerk! Promoted from chief clerk to chief clerk.
Well, don't you like it?
Chief clerk. And if I'm good, in 10 years, I'll get promoted to chief clerk again. 33 years old, and I still don't get an evening free. When am I going to begin to live?
You can begin to live on Sundays, Cornelius.
That's not living. Twice to church and old wolf trap's eyes on the back of my head the whole time. And as for holidays, what did we do last Christmas? All those rotten tomatoes went bad and exploded. We spent the whole afternoon cleaning up. Was that living?
No.
Barnaby, how much money have you got? Where can you get at it?
$3. Why, Cornelius?
You and I are going to New York.
Cornelius, we can't close the store!
Some more rotten tomatoes are going to explode!
Holy cabooses, how do you know?
Oh, I know they're rotten! All you have to do is light a match under them. They'll make such a smell, customers can't come into the place for 24 hours. They'll give us an evening free. Going to New York too, Barnaby, you're going to live. I'm going to get enough adventure to last me until I'm partner, so go and put your Sunday clothes on!
What?
Oh, I mean it. We're gonna have a good meal, and we're gonna get in danger, and we're gonna be almost arrested, and we're gonna spend all of our money!
Holy cow.
And one more thing. We're not coming back to Yonkers until we've kissed a girl.
Kissed a girl? Cornelius, you can't do that. You don't know any girls.
I'm 33. I've got to begin sometime.
I'm only 17, Cornelius. It isn't so urgent for me.
Oh, don't start packing down now. The worst comes to the worst, and we get discharged from here, we can always join the army.
Say, did I hear you say you'd be a Wolf Trap's partner?
How can I help it? He's getting up there. If you open the store at 6 and go to bed at 9, you get promoted upwards whether you like it or not.
My partner.
No way of getting around it. You and I are going to be Vandergelders.
I don't know. I may rise a little, but I'll never be a Vandergelder.
Now listen. Every person thinks that when he gets rich, he'll be a different kind of rich person than the rich people he sees out around him. Later on, he finds out there's only one kind of rich person, and he's it.
Oh, no,
the best would be a person who has all the good things of a poor person and all the good meals of a rich person. But that's never been known, no. You and I are going to be Vandergelders, so all the more reason then to try to get some living and some adventure into us now. What do you say, Barnaby? Will you come with me?
But, Wolf Trap. Yes, Cornelius!
Mr. Hassel's the trunk waiting at the railroad station.
Yes, Mrs. Levi.
Take a last look, Ermengarde.
What?
Take a last look at your girlhood home, dear. I remember when I left my home, I gave a whinny like a young colt, and off I went.
Oh, Gertrude, you think I ought to get married this way? A girl has to be awful careful.
I think I'll have this room done in red. Yes, in red.
All clear up here, Cornelius. Cornelius, hold the camera steady a minute. The bottom rows are right, but try the top now. They're swollen up like they're ready to burst! Holy caboosies! Cornelius, I can smell it here.
Put on your Sunday clothes, Barnaby. We're going to New York.
Woohoo!
Oh, Minnie, you're a fool. Of course I should marry Horace Vandergelder.
Oh, I didn't ask you. I wouldn't dream of asking such a personal question.
Oh, but that's what you meant, isn't it? And there's your answer. I shall certainly marry Horace Vandergelder, if you should ask me.
Okay, I know it's none of my business.
Wake up, Minnie. I can't hear you.
But do you... Miss Molloy, do you...
Minnie, you're a fool. Say it. Do I love him? Well, no, of course I don't love him. But I have two good reasons for marrying him just the same. Minnie... Put something on this hat. It's not ugly enough.
Oh, not ugly enough?
I couldn't sell it. Put a sponge on it.
A sponge? Why, Mrs. Molloy, you're in such a mood today.
In the first place, I shall marry Mr. Vandergelder to get out of the millinery business. I've hated it since the first day I had anything to do with it. Minnie, I hate hats.
Well, what's wrong with the millinery business?
Oh, I can no longer stand of being suspected of being a wicked woman when I have nothing to show for it. I just can't stand it.
Well, no one would dream of suspecting you.
Minnie, you're a fool. All millinesses are suspecting you of being a wicked woman. Why, half the time the women come to the shop merely to look at me.
Oh.
They enjoy the suspicion, but they aren't certain. Why, if they were certain I was a wicked woman, they would put foot in this place again. Do I go to restaurants? No, it'd be bad for business. Do I go to theaters or balls or operas? No, it would be bad for business. The only men I ever meet are feather merchants. Minnie, what are those two young men doing out there on that park bench? Take my word for it, Minnie. Either I marry Mr. Vandergelder or I'll break out his place like a fire engine. I'll go to every theater and ball and opera in New York City.
But Mr. Vandergelder's not...
Speak up, Minnie. I can't hear you.
Okay. I just don't think he's that attractive.
But what I think he is, and it's very important, I think he'd make a good fighter.
Oh, Mrs. Molloy!
Oh, take my word for it, Minnie. The best in married life is in the fights. The rest is merely so-so.
Oh, I won't listen.
Peter Molloy, God rest him, he was a fine arguing man. I pity the woman whose husband slams the door and walks out of the house at the beginning of an argument. Peter Molloy would stand up and fight for hours on end. He'd even throw things, Minnie, and there's no pleasure to equal that. When I felt tired, I'd suit a good blood-warming fight to take 10 years off my age. Now, Mr. Vandergelder will put up a good fight. I know it. I have a mind to marry him.
I just think they're awful, the things you're saying today.
Oh, I'm enjoying them myself, too. What became of Elliot?
Oh, Miss Molloy! Those men out there in the street!
What?
Oh, there's two men out there in the street. It looks as if they want to come in.
Oh, it's time some men came into this place.
Aren't you terrible?
I give you the younger one, Minnie.
Oh, Mrs. Molloy!
Oh, wait till I get my hands on that older one. Take my word for it, Minnie. We'll get an adventure out of this yet. Adventure. Why does everyone get adventures except me, Minnie?
Mrs. Molloy.
Oh, because I have no spirit. I have no gumption. Oh, Minnie, they're coming in here. Let's go up into the workroom and make them wait for us a minute.
Oh, no, but Mrs. Molloy, my word. Oh,
hurry up, Minnie.
Okay.
No one's here.
There were some women here a minute ago. I saw them.
Oh, that's old Wolf Trap, all right. We'll just have to hide here until he passes by.
He's sitting down on that bench. It may be quite a while.
Okay, when these women come back, we'll just have to make conversation with them until he goes away. We'll pretend we're buying a hat. How much money have you got left?
Huh, let's see. Okay. 40 cents for the train, 75 cents for dinner, 25 cents to see the whale, and $1. I lost. I have 70 cents.
I have $1.75.
I wish I knew how much hats cost.
Is this an adventure, Cornelius?
No, but it may be.
I think it is. There we wander around New York City all day and nothing happens. And then we come to the quietest street and suddenly Mr. Vandergelder turns the corner. I think it is. I think, Cornelius, I think Mrs. Levi's there too. Yeah, she's sitting down that bench next to him.
Oh, what do you know about that? We know one person in all New York City and there she is.
Huh. Even if our adventure came along now, I'd be too tired to enjoy it. Why isn't this an adventure, Cornelius?
Don't be asking that. When you're in an adventure, you'll know, all right?
But what if I don't? Cornelius starts to arrange a signal for you to give to me when an adventure is going on. For instance, you say, pudding! You say pudding to me if it's an adventure we're in.
I wonder where the woman is who runs this store. What's her name again?
Mrs. Malloy, Hats for Ladies.
Oh, yes. I have to think up what I'm going to say when she comes in. Good afternoon, Mrs. Malloy. Wonderful weather we've been having. We've been looking everywhere for some beautiful hats.
That's fine, Cornelius.
Wonderful weather we've been having. We'll make her think that we're very rich. Wonderful weather we've been having. Keep an eye on the door the whole time. We've been looking everywhere for some beautiful hats.
Oh, I'm sorry. Have I kept you waiting? Good afternoon, gentlemen.
Here, Cornelius Hat.
Here, Barnaby Tucker.
I'm very happy to meet you. Perhaps I can help you. Will you sit down?
Thank you. We will. You see, Mrs. Malloy, we're looking for hats.
Is that so?
Yes, we were looking everywhere. Do you know what they said? Go see Mrs. Malloy. That's what they said. So we did. Only place we could go, really.
That's very complimentary.
And they were right. Everybody was right.
You wish to choose some hats for a friend?
Yes, exactly.
Yes, exactly.
We were thinking five or six, weren't we, Barnaby?
Five.
You see, Mrs. Malloy, with us, money's no issue, none at all.
Why, Mr. Hackle?
Oh, begging your pardon, Mrs. Malloy, what an interesting street you have. Something happening there every minute passes by and...
You're from out of town, Mr. Hackle?
Yes, we're from Yonkers. Barnaby, keep an eye on that street. You won't see that in Yonkers every day.
Yes, I will.
Not all of it.
Now, this friend of yours, couldn't she come in one day and choose the hats herself?
No, oh no, it's a surprise for her.
Indeed. Well, that might be a little difficult. It's not entirely customary. Your friend's very interested in the street, Mr. Hackle.
Yes, yes, he has reason to be.
You said you're from out of town?
Yes, we're from Yonkers.
Yonkers?
Yonkers. Yes, Yonkers. You should know Yonkers, Mrs. Malloy. Hudson River, Palisades Park. Some say it's the most beautiful town in the whole world. That's what they say.
Is that so?
You know, if you had a Sunday free, we'd really like to show you Yonkers, Mrs. Malloy.
That's very kind of you, perhaps. Now more about those hats.
Maybe Mr. Malloy would like to come see Yonkers?
I'm a widow, Mr. Hackle.
You are? That's too bad. Mr. Malloy really would have enjoyed Yonkers.
Very likely. Now, this friend of yours, is she light or dark?
Oh, I wouldn't worry about that for a minute. Any hat you like would be perfectly all right with her.
Really? Do you like this one?
Barnaby, look.
Oh, that's fine.
That's the most beautiful hat I ever saw, Mrs. Malloy.
Your friend is acting very strangely, Mr. Hackle.
Barnaby, stop acting strangely, Mr. Hackle.
What the fuck?
When the street is calm and clear, come back and talk to us. Now where was I? Yes, Yonkers. You should know Yonkers, Mrs. Malloy.
Oh, the fact is, I have a friend from Yonkers. Perhaps you know him. Oh, it's always so foolish to ask in cases like this, isn't it? It's a Mr. Vandergelder.
What was that?
So you do know him?
Horace Vandergelder?
Yes, that's right.
Know him? Why, no! No!
No!
No!
Begging your pardon, Miss Malloy, what an attractive shop you have, and where does that door lead?
Oh, why, Mr. Hackle, that's my workroom.
Everything here is so interesting. Every door, every corner. Barnaby, notice the interesting doors and cupboards. Deeply interesting. Clothes for ladies. Barnaby, take note of the table. Precious piece of furniture with a low-hanging cloth, I see.
Perhaps your friend might be interested in some of this new Italian straw, Mr. Hackle. Mr. Vandergelder is a very substantial man and very well liked, they tell me.
He's a lovely man.
Oh, yes, charming, charming.
Only one fault, as far as I heard. He's hard as nails, but other than that, a charming nature.
And a large circle of friends?
Oh, yes, indeed, five or six.
Five.
He comes and calls on you here from time to time, I suppose.
This summer, we'll be wearing ribbons down our backs.
Cornelius!
I'm expecting a call from him this afternoon.
Oh. Look out!
Oh, beg your pardon, Miss Malloy!
Gentlemen, get right out of there this minute! What are you doing?
If you'll help us out just this once, I'll explain everything later.
No, Mr. Hackle!
We're as innocent as can be, Mrs. Malloy!
Gentlemen, what are you doing? I can't have this!
Psst, Cornelius! Pudding!
Pudding!
Irene, my darling child, how are you?
Oh, heavenly good help.
Well, you look.
Oh, but what a surprise. And Mr. Vandergelder in New York, what a pleasure.
Good afternoon, Miss Malloy.
Yes, Mr. Vandergelder's in New York. Yonkers lies up there decimated today. Irene, we thought you'd pay a very short call. I do, but it's not inconvenient.
Inconvenient? gave you Dolly the idea?
You waited outside a moment.
Mr. Vandergaard thought he saw two customers coming in. Two men?
Men? Mm-hmm. Men, Mr. Vandergaard, what will you be saying next?
Oh, then we'll just sit down for a minute or two.
Oh, no, before you sit down, I'd like to show you something. I'd like to show Mr. Vandergaard my workroom.
Oh, I've seen the workroom 100 times. I'll stay right here and sign on some of these hats.
No, I have something for you. Come along, everybody. Now, Mr. Vandergaard, I need some advice. You don't know how helpless a woman in business is. Why, I feel like I need advice every minute from a fine business head like yours. Now, we're all in the workroom.
Psst. Maybe we should go now, Cornelius.
Certainly I won't go. Mrs. Malloy will think we're foolish fellows. Now, I just want to stretch a minute.
What are we going to do when Mr. Vandergaard goes, Cornelius?
I don't know yet, but I like Mrs. Malloy a lot. We'll just have to buy a hat. Even if we have to take all night to walk back to Yonkers. I wish I knew how much hats cost. Barnaby, give me the money you've got left. Oh! Oh, the perfumes in there tickle my nose. But I like it in there. It's very different. It's a women's world.
I like where I am too, only I'd like it better if I had a pillow.
Here, take this coat. I'll roll it up as to not muss it. Ladies don't like it when you muss their coats.
Oh, that's fine. Now I can just lie here and listen to Mr. Vandergaard talk.
This summer we'll be wearing ribbons down our backs.
Can I take my shoes off, Cornelius?
Isn't the world full of wonderful things? There we sit, cooped up in Yonkers for years and years, and all the time, wonderful people like Mrs. Malloy are just walking around New York, and we don't know them at all. I don't know if you can see from where you're seated the place where her eye and forehead and cheek meet up here, can you? Oh, or the kind of fireworks that shoot out of her eyes all the time? I tell you now, a fine woman is the greatest work of God. You can talk all you want about the pyramids or Niagara Falls, but they're not in it at all. Of course, up at Yonkers, they would talk to me. I would come into the store, they'd say, I'd say, yes, ma'am, and that'll be 75 cents, ma'am. I'd watch them. But today, I've talked to one equal to equal. And the finest one that's ever existed, in my opinion. They're so different from men. They're so different from men in the way they think and everything that you just feel like laughing all the time. Oh, and they have a sort of wall all around them of pride and sort of play acting, and you never really know what's going on in their heads. I bet you could know a woman for 100 years and never be really sure if she liked you or not. This minute, I'm in danger. I'm in danger of losing my job and my future and everything that everybody says is important, and I don't care. Even if I have to dig ditches for the rest of my life, I'll be a ditch digger who once had a wonderful time. Barnaby.
Oh, you woke me up.
Barnaby, we can't go back to Yonkers yet. And do you know why?
Why not?
We've had a good meal. We've had our adventure. We've been in danger of getting arrested. There's just one more thing we have to do before we can go back to Yonkers and be successes.
Cornelius, you're not going to kiss Mrs. Malloy.
Maybe.
But she'll scream.
Barnaby, you don't know anything at all. For all you know, everybody else, except for us, is going through life kissing left and right all the time.
Well, thanks for telling me, Cornelius. I often wondered.
Just a minute, Irene. I must find my handkerchief. Why, Mr. Hackle, I thought you were up to Yonkers.
I almost always am, Mrs. Levi. Uh-huh. Oh, Mrs. Levi, please don't tell Mr. Vandergaard. I can explain everything later.
We're terribly innocent, Mrs. Levi.
Who's that?
Barnaby Tucker, just paying a call.
Who else is here?
No, it's just the two of us.
Okay. Old friends of Mrs. Malloy's, is that it?
Actually, we didn't know it before a few minutes ago. But we like her a lot, don't we, Barnaby? In fact, I think she's the finest person in the whole world. I'm ready to tell that to anybody now.
And does she think you're the finest person in the world?
Oh, no, I don't suppose she knows I exist.
I think she must notice you exist in that cupboard, Mr. Hackle. If I were you, I'd get back in it. Somebody could be coming in any minute.
Can I help you, Dolly?
No, I was just blowing my nose.
Miss Malloy, I've got some advice to give you about your business.
Oh, advice from Mr. Vandegrift. The whole city should hear this.
And the first point, the aim of business is to make profit.
Is that so?
I never heard it put so clearly before. Did you hear it?
Miss Malloy, you pay those girls of yours way too much. You pay them as much as men. Girls like that, Miss Malloy, enjoy their work. Wages are paid to make people do work they don't want to do.
Miss Vandegrift thinks so ably, and that's exactly the way his business is run up at Yonkers.
Miss Malloy, I'd like for you to come up to Yonkers with me.
Very nice of you. In fact, I know someone from Yonkers. Someone else.
Oh, who is that?
Someone quite well-to-do, I believe, yet a little free and easy in his behavior. Mr. Vandegelder, do you know a Cornelius Hackle up in
Cornelius
Yonkers?
Cornelius Hackle? I know him like I know my own boot. He's my clerk.
Is that so?
He's been in my shop for 10 years.
Well, I never...
Where would you have known him?
Just one of those chance meetings, I suppose.
Yes, just one of those chance meetings.
Chance meetings? Cornelius Hackle has no right to chance meetings. Where was it?
Mr. Vandegelder, it's very unlike you to question me in such a way. I think Mr. Hackle is a little... Well, no, than you think he is.
Nonsense.
He's in New York often, and he's very well-liked.
Well, the truth might as well come out now as later. Mr. Vandegelder, Irene is quite right. Cornelius Hackle's off in New York, goes everywhere, has an army of friends. Everybody knows Cornelius Hackle.
Cornelius Hackle never comes to New York. He works all day in my shop, and at 9 o'clock at night, he goes to sleep in the brand room.
Oh, so you think, but it's not true.
Molly Gallagher, you're crazy.
Listen to me! You keep your nose so deep in your account books, you don't know what goes on. Yes, by day, Cornelius Hackle is your faithful, trusted clerk, that's true. But by night, well, he leads a double life, that's all. He's in all the great restaurants and all the great homes and all the fashionable opera houses. Why, he's at the Harmonia Gardens restaurant 3 nights a week. The fact is, he's the wittiest, gayest, naughtiest, most delightful man in New York. Well, he's just the famous Cornelius Hackle.
It ain't the same man. If I ever thought Cornelius came to New York, I'd discharge him.
Who took the horses out of Jenny Lynn's carriage and pulled her through the streets?
Who?
Cornelius Hackle. Who dressed up as a waiter at the Fifth Avenue Hotel the other night and took an oyster and dropped it right down Mrs. Oh, no, it's too wicked to tell you.
No, do tell it, Dolly, go on.
No, but it was Cornelius Hackle.
It ain't the same man, Dolly.
Mm-hmm.
Where'd he get the money?
Oh, but he's very rich.
Rich?
Uh-huh.
I keep his money in my safe. He has $146.35.
Ha! Mr. Vandegelder, you're killing me. Do come to your senses. He's one of the Hackles.
The Hackles?
They built the Raritan Canal.
Then why should he work in my shop?
Oh, well, I'll tell you.
I don't want to hear it. I've heard enough. You can't get away from the facts, Dolly. I just made him my chief clerk.
If you had any sense, you'd make him partner. Now, Irene, I can see you were quite taken with him.
Oh, Dolly, I only met him once and very hastily.
Oh, yes, but I can see you were quite taken with him. Now, don't you be thinking of marrying him?
Dolly, why would he be saying this?
Oh, maybe it'd be fine, but think it over carefully. He breaks hearts like hickory nuts.
Who?
Cornelius Hackle.
Miss Malloy, how often has he called on you?
Mr. Vandegelder, I'm telling you the truth. I only met him once in my life. Mrs. Levi's been exaggerating, so I don't know where to look.
Oh, excuse me, Mrs. Malloy. I just want to get that package ready for Mrs. Parkington.
Yes, we better get that out before closing.
Oh, yeah, I want to send it off by the errand girl before midnight. Oh, I almost forgot the coat.
Oh, no,
Minnie! Miss Malloy! There's a man!
No, there's not, Minnie!
No, there's
Minnie!
A man!
No, there's help! Minnie, you're
tired!
Minnie,
there's
a man! Minnie,
you're
tired!
There's a man in there! Get him out of there! Whoever you are, come out of there
now! There's no man in there, see? Oh, yes, yes, just her coat. Miss Bay's nerves are being tricks on her. Sit down. What were you saying, Mr. Vandegelder? Go on, sit down. What were you saying? Well, now. God bless you!
Oh, no, there is a man in there, but I'll explain it all another time. Thank you for coming to see me, Mr. Vandegelder. Good afternoon, Dolly.
You're protecting a man in there.
Yes, but there's a very simple explanation, but for the present, good afternoon.
Lord, the room's crawling with men. I'll never get over it.
World's going to pieces. I can't believe my...
Oh, Mr. Vandegelder, Ernestina Simple is waiting for us.
Miss Malloy, I shan't trouble you again and vice versa.
Now, Irene, when I think of all the interesting things you have in this room, make the most of it, dear. Goodbye. Goodbye.
No, Mrs.
Oh, come right out of there right now, Barnaby Tucker, you troublemaker. Come right here. Oh, Minnie, there's no need to be afraid of these men. I know all about them. You think because you're so rich you can make up for all the harm you do, is that it?
No.
Well, Minnie, this is the famous Cornelius Hackle who goes around New York tying people into knots. And this is Barnaby Tucker, another troublemaker.
How do you do?
Minnie, pick any hat in the store. We're going out to dinner.
Pardon?
Well, if this Mr. Hackle is so rich and gay and charming, he's going to be rich and gay and charming with us. He dines 3 times a week at the Harmony Gardens. Well, he's taking us there now.
But Mrs. Malloy, are you sure it's safe?
Minnie, hold your tongue. We're in a position to put these men in jail if they so much as squeak.
Jail, Mrs. Malloy!
Jail!
Jail, Mr. Hackle. Officer Cogarty does whatever I tell him to. Minnie, We were a respectable woman for years, and now we're in disgrace. Might as well make the most of it. Go to the workroom and perk up your appearance. You gentlemen, wait here.
Oh, Mrs. Lloyd, I hear there's an awfully good restaurant at the railway station.
The railway station? Railway station, Mr. Heckler? Certainly not, no, sir. You are going to give us a fine dinner in the heart of the fashionable world. Go on in, Minnie. Don't you boys forget that you made us lose our reputations, and now the fashionable world is the only place we can eat.
She's angry at us, Cornelius.
Maybe we should run away now.
Jail or no jail, I'm going through this if it kills me. Barnaby, for a woman like that, a man could consent himself to go back to town because it'd be a success.
All I know is that no woman's going to make a success out of me.
We are taking these ladies out to dinner, so grit your teeth.
The cab's at the corner, so forward march.
Yes, ma'am. Mrs. Malloy, is it far to the restaurant? Couldn't we walk?
Take off your things, Minnie. We're not going.
Oh, but Mrs. Malloy!
Mrs. Malloy!
I don't go anywhere. I'm not wanted. Good afternoon, Mr. Hackle. I'm not very happy to have met you.
Mrs. Malloy!
You think we're not fashionable enough for you? Is that it?
No, no!
Well, I don't want to be a burden to you. Good afternoon, Mr. Tucker.
Mrs. Malloy, we want you to come with us more than anything in the world.
No, you don't. Look at you. Look at the both of them. Scowling, the pair of them.
Please.
Well then, go on. Smile. No, that's not enough. Minnie, let's go over to the workroom and we'll make our own supper.
Barnaby, smile, you laugh!
He's getting stretched, he's coming out there!
Well, if you want us to come with you, you must show some interest. Do something lively, sing.
Oh, God, I can't sing, really, I can't.
Mr. Hackle, if you want us to come with you, you must show some interest.
Barnaby, what songs do you know? Mrs. Malloy, all we know are sad songs.
Well, it doesn't matter, Mr. Hackle. If you want us to come with you, you must sing.
Tenting tonight, tenting on the old campground.
We'll come. You boys go ahead. Minnie, lock the front door key and I'll get the workroom.
Oh, wait, Mrs. Malloy! Oh, you're crying!
Minnie, isn't the world full of wonderful things? Now, watch me, dear, and tell me if my petticoat's showing.
Now hear what I say. I want a table set for three.
For three?
Yes, there will be two ladies and myself.
That's a bad combination, Mr. Van de Gelder. You'll regret it.
And I want a chicken.
A chicken? You'll regret
it. Hold your tongue! Write it down, chicken.
Chicken Esther Hazy, chicken a la creme, chicken hunter style.
Chicken like everybody else has.
What's that?
Chicken. I want a bottle of wine.
Moselle, Chablis, Bourgeois.
He doesn't understand English, Mr. Van de Gelder. You better speak louder.
W-I-N-E!
Vine!
Vine! I want this table removed. We'll eat alone.
There's some people coming in here now, Mr. Van de Gelder.
Just my niece and that art. Hey, what are they doing here? Well, traitors! The scoundrels!
Mr. Van de Gelder, remember what Napoleon said-
Levi's with them too, until I get my hands on them!
Remember what Napoleon said, Mr. Van de Gelder.
Napoleon said what?
First, observe the enemy. Watch, listen, hear what they're planning, how to spot them, sir. Be a Napoleon, Mr. Van de Gelder.
Enjoy yourself. Enjoy yourself, Ermengarde, dear. There's nothing wicked about being in a restaurant. There's nothing wicked even about being in New York. Clergymen just make those things up to fill out their sermons.
But I don't want to eat in a public restaurant like this.
Oh, that's all right, dear. There are some lovely private rooms upstairs just meant for shy, timid girls like us.
Oh.
Staff, I want to write a note.
Yes, excuse me?
Go and call that cabman in here. I want to talk to him.
No one asks advice of a cabman. They see so much life they don't have any thoughts.
Do as I tell you, Stack.
Yes, Mr. Van de Gelder. Advice of a cabman.
Dear Miss Flora Van Huysen. Everybody's dear in a letter. It's enough to make you stop writing it. Dear Miss Flora Van Huysen. It's Ermengarde and that rascal Emeralds Kemper. They're trying to run away.
What's he want?
Keep your house until I get there.
What's he want?
I want to talk to you.
I'm engaged and waiting for my parties.
I'm know you are. You want to earn $5?
Eh?
I said, do you want to earn $5?
I don't know. I never tried.
When those parties of yours come downstairs, I want you to take them to this address. Never mind what they say, this address. Give this letter to the lady of the house, ring the bell, see that they get in there, and stay there.
I can't make a person go into a house if they don't want to.
Maybe for $10?
Even for $10, I can't do it alone.
Simple. This fellow here will help you.
Now I'm pushing people into houses.
The address is 8 Jackson Street, Ms. Florvin Heinz.
Even if I get them in the door, I can't be sure they'll stay there.
You can for $15.
Murder begins at $25.
Hold your tongue! It's simple. The lady of the house will help you. All you have to do is sit in the front hall and see that the man doesn't run off with the girl.
If they call the police, I can't do anything.
It's perfectly honest business. Perfectly honest. The young lady is my niece. The young lady is my niece!
Yes.
She's trying to run away with a good-for-nothing, and we're preventing it.
Oh, I know them, sir. They'll win in the end. Rivers don't run uphill.
What did I tell you, Mr. Vandegelder? Advice of a cadman!
Stack! See that this table here is removed? See that nobody else eats here. I'll be back in half an hour, and then we'll join the cabman in the box.
Yes, Mr. Vandegelder.
Who's your friend?
Friend? That's no friend. That's some employer I'm trying out for a few days.
You won't like him.
And see your business for yourself because you talk of liking employers. No one's liked employers since business began.
Oh.
No, sir, I suppose you think your horse likes you.
My old Clementine? She'd give her right feet for me.
That's what all employers think. Just think of it. Hundreds of cab horses in New York, all winky at one another. Go to the kitchen, get some whiskey. I can't be pushing people into houses while I'm sober. No, I've had 50 employers in my life, and let me tell you, this one's the most employer of them all. He talks to everyone as though he were paying them.
I had an employer once. He used to watch me. From 8 in the morning to 6 at night, just sit there and watch me. My own mother didn't find me as interesting as all that.
Yes, being employed is like being loved. You know someone's thinking about you the whole time.
Here's the place I meant. Wasn't it fine? Many takeoff for things will be here for hours.
Mrs. Malloy, are you sure you like it here? I think I feel a draft.
Indeed I do like it. It's private and it's elegant. We're gonna have a fine dinner right here in this room. Now let's forget all our troubles and call each other by our first names. Cornelius, call the waiter.
I can't make a sound. I must have caught a cold on the way over here. Where? It won't come.
I don't believe you. Barnaby, you call him.
Witcher! Witcher!
Oh, I never dreamed I would be in such a place my whole life. Irene, is this what they call a cafe?
Yes, dear, this is a cafe. I'll sit down, please. Now, Cornelius, Mrs. Levi made us to understand that every waiter in New York knew you.
Oh, they will.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
How are you, Fritz? How are you, my friend?
I am Rudolph.
Of course, Rudolph, of course. Now, listen, Rudolph. These ladies here, they're a little something to eat, if you catch my meaning. Just, if you have the time, we know how busy you are.
Cornelius, there's no need to be so familiar with the waiter.
Oh, yes, there is.
Minnie, what do you want to eat?
Oh, just anything, Irene.
No, speak up, dear. What do you want?
No, really, I have no appetite at all. Rudolph. I would like some sardines on toast and a glass of milk.
Great grindstones, that's a sensible woman. Barnaby, shake Minnie's hands. That's the most sensible woman in the whole wide world. Rudolph, bring us two gentlemen, two glasses of beer, a loaf of bread, and some cheese.
I've never heard such nonsense. We've come here for a good dinner and a good time. Minnie, have you ever eaten pheasant?
Oh, pheasant? No.
Rudolph, have you any pheasant?
Yes, ma'am. Just in from New Jersey today.
Even the pheasants are leaving New Jersey. Rudolph, write this down. Mock turtle soup, pheasant, mashed chestnuts, a green salad, and some nice red wine.
All right, Barnaby, watch me. Rudolph, write this down. Neapolitan ice cream, hot house peaches, champagne.
Champagne!
And a German band. Have you got a German band?
No, Cornelius, I won't leave you so extravagant. Champagne, but no band. Now, be quick about this, Rudolph. We're hungry.
Yes, ma'am.
Minnie, come upstairs with me a minute. I have an idea about your hair. I think it would look nice in 2 wee horns.
Ooh, horns!
Cornelius, they say in the army that you have to curry horses all the time!
Oh, I wouldn't worry about that. By the time we get out of jail, we can move right over to the old men's home.
Miss, what's that you have?
Oh, it's some champagne, ma'am.
Oh! Cornelius, it's our champagne!
No, it's for his honor, the mayor of New York City, and he's very impatient.
Well, shame on him. The mayor of New York has more important things to be impatient about. Cornelius, open it.
Ma'am! You'll kill me!
Well, take a glass first and die happy.
Ma'am, he'll kill me.
I go to a public restaurant for the first time in 10 years, and the waitstaff burst into tears. He'll kill me. Well, here, take that and stop crying, love. Barnaby, make a toast.
To all the ladies in the world, may I get to know more of them, and may I get to know them better.
The ladies!
That was very sweet and very refined. Minnie, for that I think I shall give Barnaby a kiss.
Oh!
Oh, hold your tongue, dear. I'm old enough to be his mother, and a dear wee mother I would have been. Barnaby, this is for you from all the ladies in the world.
Oh, now I can go back to Yonkers, Cornelius! Pudding! Pudding! Pudding!
Oh, look at Barnaby. He's not strong enough for a kiss since I can't stand it. Minnie, I'm enjoying myself. To think this is what goes on in hundreds of places every night while I'm at home darning my stocking. Cornelius, dance with me.
Oh, I read the hackles don't dance for Presbyterians.
No, Minnie, you dance with me.
Ooh, lovely music. Ooh.
Minnie, you dance beautifully.
Oh, me and the girls dance in the workroom and you're not looking, Irene.
You thought I'd do cross and so you asked me to dance?
Yes.
Cornelius, Jenny Lind and all those other ladies, do you speak with them often?
Irene, I've put them right out of my mind. I'm only interested in...
Rudolph, what are you doing?
A table has been reserved here. Special orders.
Oh, that party can eat inside. This veranda's ours.
I'm sorry, ma'am, but the veranda is open to anybody who wants it. Ah, here comes the man who bought the order.
Oh, excuse me.
Take your table away from here! Cornelius, throw him out!
Ma'am, my employer reserved this table at 3 o'clock this afternoon, so you can go in the restaurant. My employer said it was very important they asked this table alone.
We got here first, we plan to stay here. Alone, too.
Ladies and gentlemen, I have a suggestion.
Shut up, you! You are an impertinent, idiotic killjoy!
That's an insult.
All the facts about you are insults. Cornelius, do something. Knock it over, the table!
Knock it over!
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sorry, but if you want to eat alone, you have to go upstairs. I'm sorry, but that is the rule.
We got here first, we're gonna have a fine dinner right here in this room. Cornelius, knock it over!
Knock it over! Wait till you see my employer!
We'll do with 3 or 4 more.
Quiet down, you, and stop changing your mind. Rudolph, we're ready for the soup.
Stack, what is this? Who do I want at the table alone? What is this?
I did what I could, Mr. Vandergelder. You won't believe the savages of New York.
Everything's wrong. You can't even manage a simple task like that.
I got that, Mr. Vandergelder!
Stack!
Speak up, I can't hear you.
It's my voice again. Barnaby, can you speak out your throat?
I can't make a sound.
Well, fine, we'll put our heads together and whisper.
Who are those people over there?
Some city sparks and their girls. What goes on in the big city? Best not to think of it.
Has that couple come down from upstairs yet? I hope they haven't gone off without you seeing them.
Oh, Mr. Vandergelder, myself, and the cabman have kept our eyes on everything.
Very well. I'll wait here for my guest, and you go out to the cab.
Yes, Mr. Vandergelder. Oh, Mr. Vandergelder, did you drop something?
No, Stack. Do as I tell you.
Yes, Mr. Vandergelder.
purse. That fellow over there must have let fall during the misunderstanding about this screen. No, no, I won't look inside. $20 bills! Dozens of them! Well, I better go give it to him. You're surprised? You're surprised to see me get rid of this money so quickly, eh? Well, I'll explain it to you. There was a time in my life when my chief interest was picking up money that didn't belong to me. The law's there to protect property, but sure, the law doesn't care whether the property owner deserves his property or not. The law has to be corrected. There are several thousands of people in this country engaged in correcting that law. Well, for a while, I too was engaged in the redistribution of superfluities. A man works all his life, leaves $1 million to his widow. She sits in hotels and eats great meals and plays cards all afternoon and evening with 10 diamonds on her fingers. Call on the robbers, call on the robbers. Or a man leaves it to his son, who stands leaning against bars all night, boring the bartender. Call in the robbers. Stealing's a weakness. There's some who say you shouldn't have any weaknesses at all, no vices. But if a man has no vices, he's in great danger of making vices out of his virtues. And there's a spectacle. We've all seen it. Men who are monsters of philanthropy, or women who are dragons of purity. We've seen people who told the truth, though the heavens fall, and they fell. No. Nurse one vice in your bosom. Give it all the attention it deserves. Let your virtues spring up modestly around you. Then you'll have the miser who's no liar, and the drunkard who's the benefactor of the whole city. Well, after I had that weakness of stealing for a while, I found another. I took to whiskey. And whiskey took to me. And then I learned an important rule, which I'm going to pass on to you tonight. Never support two weaknesses at the same time. It's your combination sinners, your lecherous liars, and your miserly drunkards who dishonor their vices and bring them into bad repute. So now you see why I want to get rid of this money so quickly. I want to keep my mind free, do the credit to whiskey it deserves. And my last words to you, ladies and gentlemen, is this. One vice at a time. Excuse me. Can I speak to you for a minute?
Certainly you can. We want to apologize about the screen earlier, that little misunderstanding.
Yes, I'm very sorry.
Oh, it's nothing.
What's your name, sir?
Stack. Malachi Stack. If you ladies wouldn't mind, I'd like to speak to you for a minute. Listen, Abby, come here. Have you lost something?
Mr. Stack, in this one day, I've lost everything I own.
Well, there it is. Don't mention it.
Mr. Stack, do you know what this is? It's a miracle!
Don't mention
it. Barnaby, come here a minute. I want you to shake hands with Mr. Stack. Mr. Stack found my purse, Barnaby. The purse I lost, the purse full of money. You're a wonderful man, Mr. Stack. Stack.
No, nothing. Nothing.
Oh, I certainly am glad I went to church all those years. You're a good person to know, Mr. Stack. In a way, where do you work, Mr. Stack?
Oh, I just begun. I work for a, Mr. Vandergelder in Yonkers.
You do? It's a miracle! Here, Mr. Stack, can I give you something for the good work?
Oh, don't mention it.
Here, take that.
Don't mention it.
Dan, take that.
Ooh. I better be going.
Oh, come here and take that.
Oh. Nah, might get to like him.
Irene, I feel a lot better about everything now. I feel so good, in fact, that I'm going to tell the truth.
Oh, I've forgotten how many men get drunk so differently than women. All right, what is the truth?
If I tell you the truth, will you let me put my arm around your
waist? No! Hold your tongue, Minnie. Fine, you can put your arm around my waist just to show that it can be done in a gentlemanly way. But I must warn you, a corset is a corset.
You're a wonderful person, Mrs. Malloy.
Thank you. All right, that's enough. Now, what is the truth?
I'm not as rich as Mrs. Levi said I was.
Not rich?
I almost never came to New York. Bad, and I think you ought to know at this very minute, Mr. Vandergelder is sitting on the other side of that table.
Well, he's not going to ruin any night of mine.
So that's why you've been whispering.
Well, let's forget all about that, Mr. Vandergelder, and have some more wine. Oh, come on, you know the tune.
No, but I don't know the words.
East side, Mr. Vandergelder.
West side.
Mr. Vandergelder.
Christmas is simple.
Mr. Vandergelder, I'll never trust a woman again as long as I live.
Well, what was it?
She ran away this afternoon and got married.
She did?
Married, Mr. Vandergelder, a young boy of 50.
She did?
I'm as disappointed as you are. I can't eat a thing.
What have you ordered?
I ordered what you told me to. Chicken.
I don't think I'd face a chicken. Waiter, how do you do? What's your name?
I'm August, ma'am.
Oh, this is Mr. Vandegaard of Yonkers, Yonkers' most influential citizen. In fact, I want you to see that he served the best you have and served promptly. Oh, and there'll only be the two of us. Mr. Vandegaard has been through some trying experience today. Men hidden all over Mrs. Lloyd's store like Indians in ambush.
You don't have to tell her everything about me.
Mr. Vandegaard, if you're planning on getting married, you might as well learn right now that you have to let women be women. Now, August, we want excellent service.
Oh, yes, ma'am.
You plan things very poorly. When I plan a thing, Dolly, it takes place. Where are you going?
Oh, I'd just like to see you on the other side of that screen.
Good evening, Mrs. Levi.
Well, who was it?
Oh, just some city sparks entertaining their girls, I guess.
Always wanting to know everything. Always curious about everything. Always wanting to put your nose into other people's affairs. Anybody who lived with you would get as nervous as a cat.
What? What's that you're saying?
Said anybody who lived with you would get as nervous as a
Horace Vandegaard, get that idea right out of your head! I'm surprised that you even mentioned such a thing. Understand once and for all that I have no intention of marrying you.
I didn't mean that.
You've been hinting around at such a thing for some time, but from now on put such ideas right out of your head.
That's not what I meant at all.
I hope not. I should hope not. Horace Vandegaard, you go your way, and I'll go mine. I'm not some Irene Malloy whose head can be turned by a pot of geraniums. Why, the idea of you even suggesting such a thing.
Miss Levi, you misunderstood me.
I certainly hope I did. If I ever had any intention of marrying again, it would be to a far more pleasure-loving man than you. Why, I'd marry Cornelius Hackle before I'd marry you. However, we won't discuss the matter anymore. Here's August with our food. I'll serve it, August. Oh, thank you, dear. Here's some white meat for you, some giblets. Very tender and very good for you. Now, as I said before, you go your way, and I'll go mine. Sorry, I don't know why. I think you feel better at once. However, since you brought the matter up, there's one more thing I'm going to say.
I didn't bring the matter up at all.
We'll close the matter forever in just a moment, but sit down. Sit down. We'll close the matter forever in just a moment, but there's one more thing I'm going to say. Yes, it's true, a woman who likes to know everything that's going on, who likes to manage everything. You're right about that. But I wouldn't like to manage anything as disorderly as your household is out of control, is untidy. You have to do that yourself, God helping you.
It's not out of control.
Very well, then I say another word about it. Take more of that squash, it's good. No, Horace, a complaining, quarrelsome, friendless soul like you is no sort of companion for me. You go your way, and I'll go mine.
Stop saying that.
I won't say another word.
And I'm not those things you said I am.
What? Well, I guess you're friendless, aren't you? Armgard told me this morning you've been quarreled with your barber, man who sold a razor to your throat for 20 years. Well, excuse me, that's sinking pretty low.
We had a little discussion, and I told him that he's over. Well, at least my clerks, they like
him. They like you? Cornelius Hackle and that Barnaby? Behind your back, they call you Wolf Trap.
They don't.
No, Horace. It seems if I were the last person that liked you, and even I'm just so-so. Yes, for the rest of my life, I intend to enjoy myself. You'll be able to find some housekeeper, prepare you 3 meals for $1 a day. It can be done if you like cold baked beans. You'll spend your last days listening at cue holes for fear of someone cheating you. Oh, take some more of that.
Well, you're a damn exasperating woman.
There, you see, that's the difference between us. I've been nagging you all day to get some spirit into you. We could be a perfectly charming, winning, amiable man if you wanted to.
I don't want to be charming.
But you are. Look at you now.
Dolly,
you can't hide it.
Listening at key holes? You have no right to say such things to me.
At your age, you ought to enjoy hearing the honest truth. You and I are too old to be talking about
my age. My age. You were always talking about my age.
I don't know what your age is, but I do know that Yonkers with bad food and bad temper will double in 6 months. Let's talk of something else. But before we leave this subject, there's one more thing I'm going to say.
Even.
Sometimes, just sometimes, I think I'd be tempted to marry you out of sheer pity. And if the confusion in your household gets any worse, I may have to.
My house is not in confusion.
What?
And I haven't asked you to marry me.
Well, please don't.
And my house is not in confusion.
What? With your niece upstairs in the restaurant, right now.
I handled that better than you know.
I'm your clerk, skipping around New York behind your back.
You're in Yonkers.
Nonsense!
Do you mean nonsense?
Cornelius Hackle's on the other side of that screen this very minute.
It ain't the same man, Dolly.
All right, go on, push it, knock it down, go and see.
What? No, no, I don't believe it.
All right, eat your chicken. Now, of course, Horace, if your situation actually went from bad to worse and became actually miserable, I might feel that it was my duty to come up to Yonkers and assist you. After all, I was your wife's oldest friend.
I don't understand how you ever got any such notion. But understand now, once and for all, Dolly, I have no intentions of marrying anybody. Now I'm tired and I don't want to talk.
I won't say another word.
Irene, I think we ought to go. Here, take this money and pay the bill. Don't worry, it's not mine.
No, I'll tell you what we'll do. You boys put on our coats and veils, and when we come stamping in here, he'll think you're girls.
What, those things?
Yeah, come on.
I'm tired. I've had a long day. I'm going back to Miss Flora Van Huysen's, and then I'm going to the hotel, Dolly. So here's the money to pay for the dent. Here's the money to pay for the... Dolly, I think I've lost my purse.
Impossible, I can't imagine without your purse.
I must have left it in a cab or... I can't go back to the hotel, I'm new here. Dolly, stop eating that, I can't pay for it.
Of course, I'll be able to find some way to pay for it. Sit down and calm yourself.
Dolly Gallagher, I gave you $25 this morning.
I have a cent, I give it to my lawyer. Oh, we can borrow from Amber's Comfort upstairs.
I wouldn't.
Cornelius Hack will lend it to
us. It's in Yonkers!
Cornelius, is this Mr. Vandergiller's purse?
I didn't know it myself. I thought it was money just wandering around loose. It didn't belong to anybody.
Goodness, that's what politicians think.
Waiter! Waiter! Get off of me!
Get off!
Stop here!
Oh, Irene! Doesn't Barnaby make a good-looking girl? He ought to stay that way.
Why should we have our evening spoiled? Cornelius, I can teach you to dance in a minute. He won't recognize you.
Oh, Barnaby, it's the easiest thing. Come on, listen to that music.
Horace, you danced with me at your wedding. You danced with me at mine. Do you remember?
No. Yes.
Horace, you're a good dancer then. Don't confess to me. You're too old to dance.
Not too old to dance, Dolly. I just don't want to.
Oh, listen to that music.
I heard a cab drawing up to the door.
You imagine it. Imagination. Everything in life, like that. Disappointment, illusion, our plans, our hopes. What becomes of them? Nothing. The story of my life.
Well, pray God nothing's happened to the dear girl. Is it long journey from Yonkers?
No, but long enough for 1,000 things to happen.
Well, we've been waiting here all day. Don't you think we ought to call Miss... We ought to call the police about it or something.
The police? If it's God's will, the police can't prevent it. Oh, in 3 days, in a week, in a year, we'll know what's happened. And if anything really terrible has happened to Ermengarde, it'll be a lesson to him. That's what it'll be.
To who?
To that cruel uncle of hers, of course. To Horace Vandergill. And to anyone who tries to separate young lovers. Young lovers have enough to contend with as it is. Who should know that better than I? No one. The story of my life. There, now here, Cap, quick.
No, ma'am, I don't see anything.
There, what did I tell you? Everything's imagination, illusion.
Well, surely if they've changed their plans, Mr. Vandergelder would have sent you a message about it.
I know what's the matter. The poor child probably thought she was coming to another prison, to another tyrant. If she knew I were her friend, and a friend to all young lovers, she'd be here by now. Oh, yes, she would. Her life shall not be crossed with obstacles or disappointments as, cook, a minute ago my smelling salts were on the table, and now they've completely disappeared.
Why, there they are, ma'am, right there in your hand.
Get there! I won't inquire. Stranger things have happened.
I suppose Mr. Vandergelder was sending her down with someone?
Two can go astray as easily as...
God bless you. Oh, now here's a carriage stopping.
Well, open the door, cook. It's probably... God bless you. It's almost as though I heard voices.
I don't want to come in. This is a free country, I tell you.
Forward march.
In you go. We have our orders.
You can't take a person. Go where he doesn't want to go.
Begging your pardon, ma'am. Are you Miss Van Huysen?
Yes, I am, unfortunately. What's all this noise about?
Those are two people that Mr. Vandergelder said must be brought here and kept until he returns. Here's this letter to you.
No one has any right to tell me who I am to keep in my home if they do not want to stay.
You're right, ma'am. People are always talking about people breaking into houses. But there's more people in this world trying to break out of houses. That's what I always say.
This young lady and I have no business being here.
What?
We were asked to be jumped into a cab and asked to be driven to the station. And these two men drove us here and forced us to come inside. There's been a misunderstanding.
Is your name Miss Van Huysen?
Everyone's asking me if my name is Miss Van Huysen. I think that's a matter I can decide for myself. And we all be quiet while I read this letter. This is Ermengarde and that rascal Ambrose Kemper. I know who you two are. They're trying to run away. Story of my life. Mr. Kemper, you have nothing to fear. Who are you?
I'm Joe. I stay here till the old man comes. He owes me $15.
That's right, ma'am. We must stay here to see that they don't escape.
Dear child, take off your things. We'll have some coffee. You two go wait out in the hall and I'll send coffee out to you. Cook, take them.
But, ma'am, we're not the people you're expecting, so there's no reason that
Mr. Kemper, I'm not the tyrant you think I am. You don't have to be afraid of me. I know you want to run away with this innocent girl. Oh, get along! All my life I have suffered from the interference of others. But you shall not suffer as I did. So put yourselves entirely into my hands. Ermengarde! Where is your luggage?
I'll
find it in the morning. It's been mislaid.
Oh, mislaid. How lifelike. Well, Ermengarde, you shall put on some of my clothes.
Oh, I know I would be happy, really.
She's a shy little thing, isn't she? Timid little darling. Yeah. Cook?
Yes, ma'am.
Go put the gingerbread in the oven and get the coffee ready.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, I go and run a good hot bath for Ermengarde.
Oh, Miss Van Huysen!
Believe me, Ermengarde, your troubles are at an end. You two will be married tomorrow. You look just as I did at that age, and your sufferings have been as mine. While you're in the bath, I'll come and tell you the story of my life.
Oh, I don't like to take baths. I always catch a cold.
I do. You won't catch cold. I'll slap you all over. I'll be back in a minute.
Barnaby, do you think you could jump down from this window?
Yes, we'd kill ourselves.
Well, we'll just have to sit here and watch for something to happen. Barnaby, the situation's desperate.
Well, it began getting desperate at about 4:30, and it's gotten nothing but worse ever since. Now, if you'll excuse me, I have to take a bath and get slapped. All over.
Your bath is nearly ready. Mr. Kemper, you go into the kitchen and put your feet in the oven. Oh, it's the door. I expected your uncle.
It's another man and a girl in a cab.
Well, let them in, cook. Now, you two, come with me.
Oh, but I don't want to take a bath. I had one on Saturday.
No, ma'am, I'm sorry. It must be a mistake. Come in anyway.
But I am Mr. Vandergelder's niece. I'm Ermengarde.
I beg your pardon, miss, but you can't be Miss Ermengarde.
But I am Ermengarde, and here's my baggage.
Pleasure to meet you. I'll let Miss Van Huysen know who you think you are. She won't like it.
Well, I better leave before she sees me.
Oh, no, Ambrose, you can't go. I feel so strange here.
I know, but your uncle's going to be here at any minute.
Ambrose, you can't go.
Ambrose, you can't go.
Ambrose, you can't leave me in this crazy house with these drunken men. Ambrose, let's say you're somebody that my uncle sent to take care of me. Let's say you're Cornelius Hackle.
What's Cornelius Hackle?
You know, chief clerk at my uncle's store.
I don't want to be Cornelius Hackle. Come now, Ermengarde. I'll take you to stay with my friend's wife. Or you can stay at Miss Levi's house.
Why, it was Miss Levi who got us in this situation. Oh, I wish I was back in Yonkers where nothing ever happened.
What's all this I hear? I thought I told you two to wait out in the hall. Now, who do you say you are?
Aunt Flora, don't you remember me? I'm Ermengarde.
And you're Mr. Vandergelder's niece?
Yes.
But he has just sent me another niece named Ermengarde.
But I'm...
Who's this?
Cornelius Hackle.
Never heard of him.
chief clerk at Uncle's store?
Never heard of him. The other Ermengarde came with the man she's in love with. And that proves it. She came with a Mr. Ambrose Kemper.
Ambrose Kemper?
Yes, Mr. Hackle, Mr. Ambrose Kemper. Dear child, what is your trouble?
Why, nobody's anybody anymore.
Are you in love with this man?
Yes.
I could see it. And are people trying to separate you? I could see it. Who? Horace Vandergelder?
Yes.
Mr. Hackle, think of me as your friend. Now, we'll go into the kitchen and get warm. We'll decide who everybody else is later. Now, my dear, would you like a good hot bath?
Yes, I would.
Well, when Ermengarde gets out, you can go in.
Oh, Mr. Heisen! No, not yet!
I'll explain everything later.
Mr. Kemper! This is Mr. Cornelius Hackle. Mr. Hackle? This is Mr. Ambrose Kemper. Perhaps you two know one another.
No.
No, we don't.
Sven Heisen, I can assure you that man is not Ambrose Kemper.
And he's not Cornelius Hackle.
My dear young men. What does it matter what your names are? All that matters is that you are you. You're alive and breathing, aren't you, Mr. Hackle?
Aren't you, Miss Van Eisen?
And this dear child imagines that she is Horace Vandergelder's niece, Ermengarde.
But I am.
The important thing is that you're all in love. Everything else is illusion.
Ouch, Miss Van Eisen.
Everyone keeps asking me if my name is Miss Van... Now you two gentlemen go sit and have a nice chat. Well, this dear child has a good hot bath.
Why, Miss Van Heisen, I think I see another cab drawing up to the door.
Well, answer it.
It's three ladies in the cab this time.
Gentlemen, you can rest easy. I'll see to it that Horace Vandergelder lets his niece marry you both.
Flora, how are you?
Darling Gallagher! What brings you here?
Great heavens, Flora, what are those two drunken men doing in your hall?
I don't know. Horace Vandergelder sent them to me.
Oh, well, I brought you two ladies here in much the same condition. Otherwise, they're the finest girls in the world. I want you to meet Irene Malloy.
It's a lady to know you.
And this is Minnie Fay. I see you two gentlemen are here, too. Mr. Hackle is about to look for you somewhere here.
Oh, Mrs. Levi, I'm ready to face anything now.
Well, Mr. Vandergelder is downstairs right now. He's trying to pay for a cab without any money.
Oh, I'll help him.
This is champagne, I promise.
Yes, William dear, you had to pay the restaurant bills. You must have hundreds of dollars there, it seems.
Oh no, this is Mr. Vandergelder's purse. I couldn't give it back to him without...
There, you help him with this.
I'll take care of that, Mr. Vandergelder.
Hello, Mr. Vandergelder. How are you?
$15, Mr. Vandergelder.
It is so much. You too. So I finally caught up with you at last. I never want to see you again. Get out of here, both of you, now!
Now then, you! Stop ordering people out of my house! You can shout and carry on in Yonkers, but when you're in my house, you'll behave yourself!
Both dishonest scoundrels!
Take your hat off! Gentlemen, you stay right where you are.
Mr. Vandergelder, I can explain it!
There aren't going to be any explanations! Horace, stop scowling at Mr. Kemper and forgive him!
It's not Kemper! It's a dishonest rogue named Cornelius Hackle.
Yeah, crazy. That's Cornelius Hackle.
I know my own chief clerk.
I don't care what their names are. You shake hands with them both, or out you go.
Shake hands with these dogs and scoundrels.
Mr. Vandergelder, you've had a hard day. You want to go out in the rain now? Just for form's sake, shake hands with these men. You can start quarreling again tomorrow.
There. Don't regard that as a handshake. Never want to see you again!
Don't! Push.
Miss Van Heisen?
Yes, dear?
Do I smell coffee?
Yes, dear.
Can I have some good and...
black? Come along, everyone. We'll all go in the kitchen and have some coffee.
Stop! Cornelius!
Now, you'll be interested to know that there are two Ermengardes in there.
What are you talking?
Ephraim Levi, I'm going to get married again. Ephraim, I'm marrying Horace Vandergelder for his money. I'm going to send his money out doing all the things you taught me. Oh, it won't be a marriage in the sense that we had one, but I shall certainly make him happy. And Ephraim, I'm tired.
I'm tired of living from hand to mouth, and so I'm asking your permission, Ephraim. Will you give me away? Money, money, money. It's like the sun we walk under. It can kill and it can cure. Horace Vandegut is never tired of saying most of the people in the world are fools. I know he's right, isn't he? Himself, Irene, Cornelius, myself. But there comes a moment in everybody's life when he must decide whether to live among human beings or not. A fool among fools or a fool alone. As for me, I've decided to live among them. Well, it wasn't always so. After my husband's death, I retired into myself. Yes, in the evenings, I'd put out the cat and I'd lock the door and make myself a little rum toddy. And I'd say a little prayer, thanking God that I was independent, that no one else's life was mixed up with mine. And when 10 o'clock sounded from Trinity Church Tower, I fell off to sleep and I was a perfectly contented woman. And one night, after 2 years of this, an oak leaf fell out of my Bible. I placed it the other day my husband asked me to marry him. Perfectly good oak leaf, but without color and without life. And suddenly I realized that for a long time I had not shed one tear, nor had I been for one moment outrageously happy, nor had I been filled with the wonderful hope that something or other would turn out well. I saw that I was like that oak leaf. And on that night I decided to rejoin the human race. On that night I heard many hours stroke off from Trinity Church Tower. You and I have both known lots of people who've decided, like Horace Vandegelder, like myself for a long time, not to have anything to do with the human race. Yes, they move out among them, they talk to them, they even get married to them, but at heart, they've decided not to have anything to do with the human race. If you accept human beings and are willing to live among them, you acknowledge that every man has a right to his own mistakes. Yes, we're all fools, and we're all in great danger of creating a great deal of havoc in the world with our folly, but the one way to keep ourselves from harm is to fill our lives with the 4 or 5 human pleasures which are our right in the world, and that takes a little money. Not much, but a little. The difference between a little money and no money at all is enormous and can shatter the world. And the difference between a little money and an enormous amount of money is very slight. And that also can shatter the world. Money, oh, pardon my expression. Money is like manure. It's not worth a thing unless it's spread around encouraging young things to grow. Anyway, that's the opinion of the second Mrs. Horace Vandegelder.
Flora Van Huysen asked me to bring this to you.
Oh, thank you both. Sit down and rest yourselves.
No, I'm not tired.
What's been going on in the kitchen?
A lot of foolishness. Everybody's falling in love. Mm-hmm. I forgave them.
Uh-huh.
Ermengarde and that artist.
I knew you would.
Thank you. Dahlia. Mm-hmm. I made Cornelius Hackle my partner.
You won't regret it.
Dahlia. Mm-hmm. You said some mighty and pleasant things to me in the restaurant this evening. About my house and everything.
Let's not say another word about it.
Dolly, you have a lot of faults.
Oh, I know what you mean.
You're scheming.
Mm-hmm.
You're inquisitive.
Mm-hmm.
You're bossy.
Go on.
Dolly. You're a wonderful woman. Marry me.
Horace, stop right there.
I know I've been a fool about Miss Malloy and that other woman. But, Dolly, please forgive me. Marry me.
Horace, I don't dare. No, I don't dare.
What do you mean?
You know as well as I do that you're the first citizen of Yonkers. Naturally, you'd expect your wife to keep open house to have scores of friends in and out all the time. Any wife of yours should be used to a kind of life like that.
Hey, everybody knows you can live any way you'd like.
Horace, you can't deny it. Your wife can have to be a somebody. Answer me. Am I a somebody?
You're a wonderful woman.
Oh, you're partial. Horace, it wouldn't be enough for you to load your wife with money and jewels? To insist you to become a benefactress to half the town? Do you really think I have in me to be credit to you?
Dolly, everybody knows you can do anything you'd like.
I'll try. With your help, I'll try. And by the way, I found your purse.
Where did you?
Uh-huh.
Wonderful woman.
It just walked into my hand. I don't know how I do it. Sometimes I frighten myself. Horace, take it. Money walks out of my hand.
Dolly.
It's true.
Keep it. Keep it.
Horace, I never thought I'd ever say a thing like that.
Woo! Oh, God. Excuse me, I didn't realize anyone was in here.
I didn't realize anyone was in here. Idiot!
Come in, Barnaby, come in.
Come in, Barnaby, come in.
Cornelius is going to marry Mrs. Malloy.
Isn't that fine? Horace!
Barnaby,
mm-hmm.
I want to tell the rest of them that Miss Levi has consented.
Finally consented.
Finally consented to become my wife.
Holy cabooses! Hey, everyone! Wolf Trap, I mean, Mr. Vandergelder is going to marry Mrs. Levi.
Dolly! Look, over here. Huh?
That's the best news I've ever heard. Well, there isn't any more coffee and there isn't any more gingerbread, but there are three couples in my house and they're all going to get married.
And did you know, one of those Ermengardes wasn't even a little girl at all. She was a boy.
Uh-huh. Well, that's life. Disappointment, illusion. There isn't any more coffee, and there isn't any more gingerbread, and there isn't any more play, but there's one more thing we ought to do. Barnaby, come here. I think the youngest person here ought to tell us what the moral of the play is.
Oh, I think it's about adventure. The test of an adventure is when you're right in the middle of it, and you say to yourself, now I've got myself into a huge mess. I wish I were sitting quietly at home. And the test of something's wrong with you is when you're sitting quietly at home wishing you were out having lots of adventures. So, we'd like to thank you all for coming out tonight and hope that you had just the right amount of sitting quietly at home and just the right amount of adventure. Good night!